Hi, I'm Bob Herbert. Welcome to Op-Ed.TV. It has been 28 years since Timothy McVeigh used an immensely powerful truck bomb to blow up the Alfred P. Murrah Federal Building in Oklahoma City. It was a grotesque act of terrorism that killed 168 people, including 19 children. A compelling new book, Homegrown, Timothy McVeigh and the Rise of Right-Wing Extremism, traces the links that connect McVeigh and the Oklahoma City bombing to seemingly endless subsequent acts of tragic right-wing extremism, right up to and including the insurrection of January 6, 2021. My guest is the author of Homegrown, Jeffrey Toobin, a writer, a lawyer. He was a magna cum laude graduate of Harvard Law School and the author of several New York Times bestsellers. Jeffrey, welcome.
Hi, Bob.
Thanks for coming in. Appreciate it. This is such a good and also important book. I congratulate you on it. Let's start with who McVeigh was and why he blew up that building in Oklahoma City.
Tim McVeigh was born and raised outside Buffalo in upstate in western New York, and he had a fairly standard middle-class existence. His father worked at a GM plant for 30 years. His grandfather worked at the same GM plant for 30 years. But that plant was declining a great deal by the time McVeigh came along. Mm-hmm. So economic decline was a big part of his upbringing. Rancorous divorce of his parents. He becomes obsessed with guns, even in high school. Flounders for a year in junior college, and then enters the Army. In the Army, he excels in the first Gulf War, wins a Bronze Star, but when he comes back, he flunks out of Special Forces training, and it's a real turning point in his life. He really wanted to be a Green Beret, and he becomes really a lost soul at that point, right around the early 90s. At that point, he returns to Buffalo, but he begins to become politically radicalized. He becomes a big Rush Limbaugh aficionado. He listens to a shortwave right-wing nut named Bill Cooper, and ultimately takes off on the road, joins with his Army buddy, Terry Nichols, and they decide as a protest against federal gun control to bomb a federal building.
Wow. When and how did you come to sort of the recognition or realization that there were these links between, actually unending links, between what was going on with McVeigh and Terry Nichols and the bombing of this building, and then all this right-wing extremism that has lasted right up to and including the present day?
Well, I covered the McVeigh and Nichols trials, which were moved to Denver and took place in 1997, 2 years after the bombing. So I was familiar with the story, and the story had been rattling around in my head for many years. But what really got me back interested in was in October of 2020. That's when, as you probably remember, the FBI arrested a number of people who were plotting to kidnap the governor of Michigan, Gretchen Whitmer. Mm-hmm. And I saw that they were all affiliated with the Michigan militia. I remembered that Terry Nichols, McVeigh's co-defendant, was also from Michigan, also affiliated with the Michigan militia. And I started looking into the Whitmer plot, and I saw that not only was the ideological link clear, but some of the same people were involved in the militias over those decades. It was only a few weeks later that January 6th happened, January 6th, 2021. And again, I saw ideologically that the links between McVeigh's ideology and the January 6th ideology, starting with the obsession with guns and gun control, right, and the idea that the federal government is plotting to take away your guns, which was a fixation of both McVeigh and many of the January 6th rioters, that was what brought me back to the story. And as you point out, as I researched Homegrown, I found that ideology, it wasn't just, you know, those two things, the bombing and January 6th. It was a cascade of violence in this country of right-wing violence, including just the other day in Jacksonville, when a white supremacist killed three black people with an AR-15. Again, an example of the kind of murderous right-wing violence that McVeigh demonstrated back in 95.
And expanding on this, which you made clear in your book, there were some specific events that played directly into McVeigh's motivation. One was the disastrous occurrences at Waco, Texas, with the Branch Davidian compound. And then also, Bill Clinton was president, the assault weapons ban. So just talk briefly about how those events played into his motives.
To the extent people remember anything about the Oklahoma City bombing, I think a lot of people do remember that McVeigh chose April 19th, 1995 because it was the second anniversary of the FBI's disastrous raid on the Branch Davidian compound. McVeigh saw that as the symbol and in many respects the culmination of the evil of Bill Clinton's federal government. You know, I think it's important to point out that, you know, McVeigh is sometimes described as anti-government. Mm-hmm. He wasn't anti-all government. He was anti-Bill Clinton's federal government. He was a right-wing extremist. He was not an anarchist against all government. But as you mentioned, you know, the date of September 13th, 1994 is just as important as April 19th because that was the day that Bill Clinton signed the assault weapons ban.
Right.
And that was the final straw that persuaded McVeigh and Nichols, who had been talking about this idea of bombing a federal building, an idea that came from this horrible dystopian novel, The Turner Diaries,
right,
which McVeigh had read many times. He sold it at gun shows. He started reading it in high school. That story features a right-wing extremist named Earl Turner who uses a truck bomb to blow up the federal building, the FBI building in Washington. McVeigh wanted to do the same thing, which was blow up a federal building and, as in the novel, setting off a broader rebellion against the federal government.
And for those who may doubt that there were these links to the present day, just mm-hmm. consider that Donald Trump kicked off his current presidential campaign in Waco, Texas.
Yeah, I mean, these symbols, these tropes of the right wing, like the Turner Diaries, which was read and talked about by the Proud Boys and other people involved in January 6th.
Yep.
Waco is a symbol of the excesses of the federal government that Trump was nodding to by opening his campaign in Waco. These ideas, while McVeigh himself remains a reviled figure, I mean, only the craziest of the crazies regard McVeigh himself as a role model.
Right.
But if you look at what McVeigh stood for and what McVeigh embraced, that ideological agenda is very similar to the one we see in the right wing today.
So the two major governmental figures that play into this and which you cover extensively in your book are Merrick Garland, who is currently the Attorney General of the United States, and Bill Clinton, who, as we mentioned, was president at the time. We'll talk about both of them. First, talk about Merrick Garland, the role he played, and your take on the role that he played.
Well, Merrick Garland at the time was a senior, but not very senior, Justice Department official. He was basically the top aide to the Deputy Attorney General, Jamie Gorelick, at the time. And immediately after the bombing on April 19th, 1995, Jamie Gorelick and Janet Reno, who was the Attorney General, sent Garland to Oklahoma City to supervise the investigation. Garland actually wanted to be the lead prosecutor in the case, but again, remembering all these things that were taking place at the same time, he was pulled out of Oklahoma City because the Unabomber investigation was falling apart and they couldn't find the Unabomber. It wasn't until 1996 that they actually caught Ted Kaczynski. But Garland, you know, was deeply affected, as a normal person would be, by the carnage and the horror. But he also was affected by another event that was going on at the same time, which was O.J. Simpson's criminal trial, which had started in January of 1995. And Garland made a clear vow that this prosecution, the McVeigh prosecution, was going to be the opposite of the OJ case.
Which was a circus.
And he was someone who was deeply offended by that. And he also thought it was unproductive. As it turned out, it led to an acquittal in that case.
Right.
But he wanted a low-profile prosecution, low-profile prosecutors. He didn't want to call attention to the political dimensions of McVeigh's agenda. He simply wanted to show that McVeigh was the one who set off the bomb. That was enough. And I think it was understandable given his role at the time, but that extremely controlled, constrained avoidance of politics, I think, has affected how he's behaved as Attorney General. You know, he has been, I think, very effective in leading a prosecution. I mean, they've prosecuted 1,000 people for the riot at the Capitol on January 6th. Mm-hmm. And now, of course, they have charged President Trump with several crimes related to January 6th and then later about classified information. But what Garland has not done is talk about the broader threat of the right wing. He is someone who believes that the Justice Department should speak only in the courtroom. And I think that has been somewhat of a missed opportunity, and you can see the roots of that in his behavior in the Oklahoma City bombing.
So if you think about Garland's role and his behavior, and then you consider Bill Clinton, talk about Bill Clinton's take.
Very different and really interesting to me, because this was something I didn't know before I started working on the book.
Which, by the way, you interviewed both Merrick Garland and Bill Clinton
about
for
this,
your book.
I did. Yeah. When the bombing happened, it had been less than 2 years since the first World Trade Center bombing here in New York, and a lot of people speculated immediately, well, this must be another act of Islamic terror.
Right.
Clinton, in his initial statements, he didn't say anything about who did it. He just said, we're going to do an investigation. He made appropriate comments in public.
The bombing in Oklahoma City was an attack on innocent children and defenseless citizens. It was an act of cowardice, and it was evil.
However, I learned in my reporting back in the Oval Office, on the day of the bombing, he said, this wasn't Islamic terrorism. This was domestic. This was the militias. So when I interviewed Clinton, I said, well, how did you know?
Right.
And he said, because I dealt with these people for 12 years as governor of Arkansas. And he gave me chapter and verse of these extraordinary acts of terrorism and crime that I had been unaware of that went on in Arkansas,
right,
when he was governor. Murders of state troopers, murders of a sheriff who had actually been Clinton's campaign coordinator in northern Arkansas county. All of this showed Clinton how dangerous the right wing was in this country. And his comments, including about the incitement of right-wing radio. He didn't know how right he was. He didn't know that Tim McVeigh was a big Rush Limbaugh ditto head.
Right.
But Clinton, unlike Garland, saw and expressed the broader political threat of the right-wing in this country, and that to me was quite interesting.
So race runs through all of this stuff. It's a driving force, like a catalyst for this right-wing carnage. Talk about the importance of race and how often we're trying to, or at least the public officials and often the media, are trying to sidestep the issue of race or diminish it. Talk about the importance of race.
Well, McVeigh grew up in a classic white flight suburb. His high school graduating class in Lockport, New York, was 100% white. He started working in a security guard after high school and was exposed to Buffalo for the first time and started developing a great deal of hostility to black people, as is reflected in his affection for the Turner Diaries, which is a horribly racist and anti-Semitic book. He then goes to the Army, and he's stationed in Fort Riley in Kansas, which happens to be one of the most polarized Army bases along racial lines. And he later returns to Buffalo after he leaves the Army and convinces himself that he's not getting the jobs he wants because black people are getting the jobs. So there's this roiling racial resentment that is a big part of why he's so angry at the federal government, because he thinks the federal government is favoring black people and his kind, you know, the white ethnic from the Northeast is getting the shaft. That's a big part of his motivation. And if you look at the right-wing violence subsequently, whether it is the Dylann Roof in the church in South Carolina, whether it is shooting up the synagogue in Pittsburgh, or the grocery store in Buffalo, the Walmart in El Paso, or just the other day, Jacksonville. That racial animus is always very close to the surface when it comes to right-wing violence in this country.
Now, there were two developments, and you make this clear in your book as well, two developments over the past several years that have made it a lot easier to move from extremist rhetoric to actual acts of violence. One, of course, is the rise of the internet, the importance of the internet. And the other is the much easier access to assault weapons, things like the AK-47. Talk about how that has played into it.
Well, you know, one of the great opportunities I had with this book is Stephen Jones, the lead lawyer, donated all of his papers from the case to the University of Texas, the Briscoe Center.
He's
there.
The lead lawyer for
the lead
defense.
Lawyer for McVeigh, yes. Yeah. And so I got to see all of his communications with McVeigh. Dubious whether that should have been disclosed because of the attorney-client privilege, but that wasn't my problem.
And reading the book, I did not have any problem.
That's an issue of interest to many lawyers, why he did this, but that's okay. McVeigh said to his lawyers, I knew there was an army out there, but I couldn't find them. He wanted to find allies. He would go to gun shows. He would sell the Turner Diaries. But he didn't have the personality or the means to recruit others. And it is my belief that there was no broader conspiracy here. It was just McVeigh and Nichols.
Right.
But he didn't have the internet. He didn't have social media. And if you look at all the subsequent plots, whether it's January 6th or the Whitmer plot, or Dylann Roof in South Carolina, it's all exacerbated and spurred by what these people can use the internet for, whether it's communicating in private Facebook chats like the Michigan conspirators did, or getting on these right-wing websites like others. Social media and the internet have accelerated the right-wing communication network and made it easier for these people to find each other. The assault weapons ban that outraged McVeigh so much was actually a 10-year ban.
Yeah, it expired.
It expired in 2004. George W. Bush was president. Republicans were in charge of Congress. There was no way it was going to get reinstituted. And so what has happened, if you look at the right-wing violence of subsequent years, they don't have to go to all the trouble that McVeigh went to of building a bomb. The true crime story at the heart of Homegrown is about how McVeigh and Nichols assembled this bomb. And it's a remarkable story in and of itself,
right.
But it was difficult and complicated and time consuming. It's a lot easier to go buy an AR-15 and shoot up a school, shoot up a store. And that availability of assault weapons is something that is a major difference, and one that these really crazy evil people have taken advantage of.
And we're seeing it come to pass. And then, of course, with the internet, you look at an event like January 6th, 2021. Without the internet, that would have been a much different and a much more difficult thing.
And impossible to arrange that kind of complex, especially the more important conspirators, the Proud Boys, et cetera,
right.
that was all done using the internet.
So we should point out that McVeigh was convicted and was executed.
2001.
What happened to his sidekick?
Terry Nichols was also convicted in a subsequent trial. He received a life sentence without the possibility of parole, and he's still serving his sentence in the Supermax prison in Florence, Colorado. The state of Oklahoma, at least the district attorney in Oklahoma City, was so outraged by the fact that Nichols didn't get the death penalty. He did another trial of Nichols on state charges,
right.
But it came out the same way. He got life in prison, and so he's still serving there.
So now we have this latest version of the Republican Party, which is nothing like the Republican Party that I grew up with and
right.
spent, you know, almost half a century covering in the news business. Much of it has embraced Timothy McVeigh's ideology and his worldview. Can you talk a little bit about that?
You know, when I looked at January 6th in particular, there were three connections that I thought were really striking about, you know, how the ideology has continued from the mid-90s to today. The first is the obsession with guns.
Right.
If you look at the issue agenda of people at the Capitol on January 6th. You know, other than seeing Donald Trump back in office, it was to preserve their access to guns. McVeigh was obsessed with guns, and if you look at the right wing today, the gun obsession remains, to me, the biggest motivator of their actions. The second is a belief that violence is justified.
Right.
The Capitol, you know, the Capitol riot was not a peaceful protest. They went through the Capitol. Fortunately, they didn't kill anyone that day, although people died subsequently.
Right.
But I mean, violence as justified. And the third was one that was a big surprise to me, frankly, which was an obsession with the founding fathers of the United States. The prologue to Homegrown is called 1776. And you saw that many of the people in the January 6th protest were analogizing their work to that of the framers of the Constitution, the people who signed the Declaration of Independence. Congresswoman Boebert tweeted on the morning of January 6th, "Today is 1776." Mm-hmm. McVeigh felt the same way. McVeigh had memorized large portions of the Declaration of Independence, not just the famous part, you know, we hold
right.
these truths to be self-evident,
right.
but the part where Jefferson talks about the justification for armed rebellion against the king. He saw himself as the heir to the American colonists who fought off the tyranny of the big government. That was true of the people in January 6th as well.
We didn't pay enough attention, I'm talking about as a country, as a society, to the events that were in the air leading up to the Oklahoma City bombing, the poisonous rhetoric, the Rush Limbaughs of the world who were on the radio, Newt Gingrich and the madness that Newt Gingrich set in motion and that sort of thing. And there wasn't a sense of impending, there were violent acts occurring, but there was a sense of impending violence in the air, and I think we didn't pay enough attention. My question is, are we in danger of doing something similar now? I just get a sense. I mean, we have these mass shootings that go on almost every day. We've had attacks on public officials and stuff. Public officials get murderous threats, I guess, all day, every day, you know, somewhere. Are we in danger of sleepwalking through another potential catastrophe?
The Oklahoma City bombing was 1995. There was an increase in interest and worry, appropriately, about the militias and the right wing. But 6 years later was 9/11. And the country, in part understandably, became fixated on the fear of foreign terrorists.
Right.
And there was an attempt by many on the right to pretend that all terrorism came from Osama bin Laden
right.
or his like. And so definitely after 9/11, we took our eye off the ball. To the credit of Chris Wray, who is the FBI director now, he has talked about the right wing as the largest domestic threat in terms of terrorism. And I give him a lot of credit for that. Garland, as I said, has kept a much lower profile on that issue, which I think is unfortunate. But, you know, our history is that of having a short attention span.
Right.
And that has certainly been reflected in the threat that the right wing represents in this country. But I wrote a whole book trying to call attention to it.
So there you
go. I did my part.
You did. We're out of time. We've been talking about Homegrown, Timothy McVeigh and the Rise of Right-Wing Extremism. The author is Jeffrey Toobin. Jeffrey, thank you so much.
Thanks, Bob.
I'm Bob Herbert. Thank you for watching, and we'll see you next time.